Thank you, Minister. That concludes topical questions, and we will now move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is a statement by Hamza Yousaf on our priorities for Scotland. The First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Hamza Yousaf, First Minister, up to 20 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just a few weeks ago, I couldn't have imagined that I'd be standing here as First Minister, setting out the policy priorities and indeed the defining missions of the government that I lead. Being First Minister is, of course, not without its challenges, it's fair to say, but notwithstanding that, it is, of course, the honour of my life. And in my very first speech to this chamber after the result was announced, I made it clear that the people of Scotland's priorities will, of course, be my priorities too. And I've been clear from the outset that I intend on governing in the interests of the whole of Scotland. And I hope that today's policy prospectus that has been published is a demonstration of that. In setting out our course for the next 3 years, we are acknowledging, as we must, that Scotland faces genuinely difficult challenges. Our economy and our public services are still recovering from a global pandemic. We're in the midst of a cost crisis made worse, of course, by the UK government's economic mismanagement, which is harming people and hurting businesses right across the country. And we need to play our part in addressing the global crisis of climate change and indeed nature loss. And we are also, and this is worth stressing, facing the most difficult public spending environment that this devolved Parliament has clearly ever seen. The inflationary shocks created by a hard Brexit, a global pandemic, the war in Ukraine, disastrous decisions taken as part of the UK government's mini budget, they've all placed great pressure on the public finances. Our ability to deal with that pressure is being constrained by UK government spending decisions and, of course, a lack of borrowing powers. In fact, the cost to Scotland of Westminster control, the cost of not being independent, has never been clearer. UK living standards have stagnated for 15 years. Indeed, the fall in living standards this year and the next is expected to be the largest on record. According to the IMF, the UK is to be amongst the worst performing of any major economy this year. And the disastrous impact of Brexit, supported, of course, by both the Tories and Labour, is biting hard. And as a result, we have to make really tough decisions about our priorities. And I will be unapologetic about making those difficult decisions to ensure we free up money, we free up resource to target it to those who are in the greatest need. And where we can, we'll go even further within the constraints of devolution. And where we can go further, I absolutely will. But for all the significant challenges we face, and they are significant, we also know that we can build on the important successes. Scotland currently outperforms the UK on unemployment rate, with the unemployment rate for men over 16 at the lowest on record. NHS waiting times, our court backlogs improving following the pandemic. And despite the public spending climate, we have expanded free childcare provision and introduced the game-changing Scottish Child Payment. And of course, Scotland continues to have a highly skilled workforce, world-class universities and colleges, and huge potential in some of the key economic sectors of the future. The Scottish Government is today publishing their policy prospectus, New Leadership, A Fresh Start for Scotland, which will set out how this government, the government I lead, will address our challenges, build on the successes of the past, but also capitalise on our strengths. It sets out the key aims, the key deliverables we intend to achieve in each Cabinet Secretary's portfolio, working constructively, of course, with our Green Party colleagues. Throughout the next 3 years, we will report routinely, regularly and transparently on our performance against these aims and against these outcomes. The report also emphasises that this government's work will be defined by three distinct and interdependent missions. Those missions, centred on the principles of equality, opportunity and community, require us to tackle poverty, to build a fair, green and indeed a growing economy, and to improve our public services. They will be central to our efforts over the next 3 years to improve the lives of the people of Scotland. The first mission, based on equality, is that we will continue to tackle poverty in all of its forms, and that we will substantially reduce child poverty in particular. An immediate focus inevitably will be on protecting people as far as we possibly can from the harm inflicted by the UK government policies and the ongoing cost of living crisis. That means that we will often choose to target spending so that it will benefit those who need it the most. That's one reason why the very first action I undertook as First Minister was to increase the Fuel Insecurity Fund to £30 million. Over the next 3 years, we'll also invest a further £1.3 billion in the Scottish Child Payment. We will further develop our social security system and ensure it continues to treat people with dignity, with fairness and respect. We will expand the provision of free school meals. We'll reduce the number of children who go into care. We'll keep our promise to those who are care experienced. And we'll work to ensure that drug deaths reduce over the next 3 years. And we recognise just how crucial housing is to our aspirations of a fairer country. We'll continue to work with local government to reduce the number of people living in temporary accommodation. And subject, of course, to the will of this Parliament, we will legislate to secure a new deal for tenants and to introduce duties to prevent homelessness. We will invest to make homes and buildings greener, and we will continue to deliver affordable homes, the majority of which will be for social rent in all parts of our country. We will also publish an action plan for housing in remote, rural and island areas. I can confirm today that this plan will include up to £25 million from our affordable homes budget to allow suitable properties, including empty homes, to be purchased or indeed long leased and turned into affordable homes for key workers and others. We'll also engage with the public to explore how best we can use our existing taxation powers to deliver the most progressive taxation system in the UK and achieve the government's three missions, which I talked to today. Scotland is a wealthy country, but that wealth is not distributed evenly. To tackle poverty, we need to be even bolder on taxation and the redistribution of wealth. That is why I will convene an anti-poverty summit, inviting experts, academics, anti-poverty campaigners, those with lived experience. I'll also invite, of course, opposition colleagues, as I believe tackling poverty is a shared priority for us all. We'll continue to support equality, inclusion, and human rights too. We'll implement more of the recommendations of the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls. Presiding Officer, I take great pride in being the first Minister from an ethnic minority background. I know my rights are very much interdependent on the rights of others. The government I lead will not only protect the rights of minorities where possible, we will also advance them, particularly for those that are the most marginalised in our society. During the parliamentary term, we will bring forward a human rights bill to incorporate, within the limits, of course, of our devolved competence, international standards on economic, social, cultural and environmental rights. That is, of course, in stark contrast, I should say, to a UK government that pursues divisive immigration policies. It risks denying sanctuary to people during their hour of need. We will continue to support those who come to Scotland fleeing war and indeed fleeing persecution, and will continue to support the many thousands of people who have come from Ukraine during the last year. For as long as Scotland is their home, they will be welcomed here and they will be supported. Presiding Officer, through these actions and many more, we will make significant progress towards making Scotland a fairer country during the next 3 years. However, we know that our ambition to make Scotland fairer must go hand in hand with our work to make Scotland more prosperous. That's why the second national mission is based on the principle of opportunity, using all of the powers we have to their maximum effect to support economic growth for a purpose, to help businesses and trade to thrive and to maximise the opportunity for a fair green economy. A crucial part of this is about making a just transition to net zero. We will never do to oil and gas workers in the north-east of Scotland what Thatcher did to our mining and steel communities. We will take the workers of the north-east. We will take the workers of the north-east and indeed the whole of Scotland with us on our just transition journey. We will harness the huge potential of the green economy in Scotland. The ScotWind programme on its own, for example, offers the potential of £28 billion of supply chain work based in Scotland. Our renewable energy resources will also help us to develop a new hydrogen sector, which is why a focus for the next 3 years is to lay the foundations for a hydrogen supply chain in Scotland. Excuse me. We will also continue to support innovation and entrepreneurship. Through policies such as our investment in new tech scalar hubs, we hope to make Scotland one of the leading nations in Europe for business startups. We will also develop centres of excellence for sectors such as green technologies, health and life sciences, digital industry, and advanced manufacturing. And as we do this, we will seek to support economic growth and ensure that wealth is far more evenly distributed. So we will continue to invest in skills so that people are able to take advantage of new opportunities. We'll encourage growth in every part of Scotland by working with local and regional partners. In setting out our plans for the economy, I also want to make a broader point about the government's relationship with our business community. Presiding Officer, I'm the proud son of a business owner. In fact, just this month, my dad's business turned 40 years old, and despite our family efforts to the contrary, Mr. Yusuf Senior has no plans to retire just yet. But businesses, and small businesses in particular, are the backbone of our economy, and government support for business is essential for the delivery of a well-being economy. We need businesses to grow, to create those good, well-paying jobs that will enable us to reinvest in initiatives to eradicate poverty. We also rely on businesses and, of course, their workers to pay taxes that our public services rely on. That's why there has never been a conflict, to my mind, between supporting our economy to grow in line with our net zero ambitions and introducing policies such as progressive taxation, which enables us to reduce poverty. Both go hand in hand as part of that well-being economy many of us support. We also need some government regulation of business. The business community itself recognises that an unrestricted market is incompatible with the well-being of our people, our communities, and, of course, our environment. But the balance here needs to be right. A number of business organisations have expressed concern in recent months about the balance that the Scottish Government has been striking. In fact, they have called for a reset of the relationship between business and government. And I'm happy to start that reset today. And I want to do so by confirming three specific steps. The first relates to the deposit return scheme. I remain committed to this scheme as a way to increase recycling, to reduce litter on our streets and our beaches, and help achieve our net zero ambitions. But we recognise the uncertainty that continues to be created as a result, of course, of the UK government delaying the decision to exclude the scheme from the Internal Market Act. Of course, we had hoped for a decision on that this week, but it has not come. At the same time, I and the Circular Economy Minister have heard the concerns of business, particularly about the scheme's readiness for launch this August. And as a result, we will now delay the launch of the scheme to the 1st of March 2024. I'm pleased that has got universal support around the Chamber. This provides 10 months for businesses to get ready. We'll use that additional time, of course, to work with Business and Circularity Scotland to address the concerns with the scheme.
Excuse me, First Minister, I had given a bit of latitude, but it is getting quite noisy.
That's okay, Presiding Officer. They are really excited about the policy perspective that I'm bringing forward to this chamber today. It's not a problem. I've always said that I will reach across the political divide where necessary. We will use that additional time, of course, to work with businesses and Circularity Scotland to address concerns with the scheme and ensure a successful launch next year. We've also developed a package of measures to simplify and de-risk the scheme and to support small businesses and hospitality in particular. And the Circular Economy Minister, of course, will provide further details to Parliament this week on this package of the new timetable and our engagement with the UK Government over the critical decisions now that we need them to make to allow the scheme to proceed in terms of that exemption of the Internal Market Act. The second step relates to the Scottish Government's consultation on restrictions to alcohol advertising. The aim of this consultation to reduce the harm caused by alcohol to children It is not just admirable, it's one that I support wholeheartedly. But it's clear that some of the proposals have caused real concern to an industry which is already facing challenges on multiple fronts. I've therefore instructed my officials to take these ideas back to the drawing board, work with industry and, of course, crucially, public health stakeholders to agree a new set of proposals. I believe that all of us want to reduce the harm caused by alcohol, particularly to young people, but without undermining Scotland's world-class drinks industry or tourism sector. I'm hopeful that by taking a fresh look at this issue, we can find a way forward which achieves both of these crucial aims. Finally, I've written to key business representative groups and asked them to engage in urgent discussions with the Scottish Government to agree a new deal for Scottish businesses. These discussions will be chaired jointly by the Cabinet Secretary for the Wellbeing Economy and a representative of the business sector. The discussions will explore, amongst other things, how government can better support our businesses and communities using the policy levers we do have, including non-domestic rates. I've asked the co-chairs to report back to me with initial thoughts this summer. These three steps with all, I trust, will be welcomed individually by Scotland's business community, but I hope that collectively they also send a broader signal about this government's approach to business. This government knows that Scotland can only be successful if our businesses are successful. And so as First Minister, at my door will always be open to you. We might not always agree, but I will always give you a fair hearing, and I will seek to address your concerns wherever possible. All three of the missions that I'm setting out today depend on the thriving business sector in Scotland. So the government I lead will do everything we can to help you to prosper. The third and last of our missions, which is based on community, is to focus on the delivery of key public services. For example, the NHS and social care, schools and childcare, the police and justice, and public transport. The NHS in the last 3 years has faced the greatest challenge in its 74-year existence. Its staff have performed magnificently in the face of the pandemic. We will invest in the NHS to help it recover from the pandemic so that over the next 3 years, waiting lists will fall. The outcomes for cancer treatment will improve. We'll continue to support primary care. We'll invest more in general practice, particularly in the most disadvantaged areas of the country. We will also improve mental health and welfare support. We'll secure better access to NHS dentistry. We're also committed to improving social care services and reducing delayed discharge. I know well the workforce challenges that the adult social care sector in particular faces. That is why I will commit to a timetable that sets out how this government will get to £10 an hour for adult social care workers. While we're not able to afford to do this absolutely immediately, I want to send a signal to the sector that we are absolutely serious about improving pay, about improving terms and conditions for those who care for our most vulnerable. And a key way of improving consistency of care is, of course, through the National Care Service, in a way that commands consensus amongst our key partners, including trade unions, including local government. Yesterday, I confirmed we would ask and seek from Parliament an extension to the scrutiny process for the legislation that will help us to build that consensus. The aim of the National Care Service legislation, ensuring that consistently high standard of care right across the country, is one which attracts wide support. My hope is that by taking slightly more time to agree a way forward, we can ensure that we agree and achieve that aim. We'll also continue to ensure that staff in our health and care services are valued and that they're fairly paid. As things stand, Scotland is the only part of the UK where no NHS worker has gone on strike during the last year. That's something I'm proud of and I'm grateful for. The Scottish Government will soon enter into talks with junior doctors in the hope of arriving at a fair settlement for them. And as well as supporting our NHS and care services, we'll also continue to invest in other key public services. In the justice system, the backlog of court cases caused by the pandemic is already decreasing. It will continue to fall during the next 3 years. We'll continue to implement important improvements in our justice system, such as better handling of cases involving sexual offences. We will improve childcare for school-aged children. I'll accelerate the expansion of childcare for 1- and 2-year-olds. We'll continue to focus on closing the poverty-related attainment gap in schools while raising the attainment for all. will improve experiences and outcomes for children, for young people and their families who use and need that additional support for learning. And as part of our efforts to improve school education, we'll increase the availability of internationally comparable data on Scotland's educational performance. Scotland already participates in the widely respected PISA studies. We also know that we will also now apply to rejoin two major international statistics systems, Trends in International Maths and Science and Progress in International Reading Literacy. We'll also make our public transport system more accessible. We'll make it more available. We'll make it more affordable. And as an important part of that, I can confirm today that the six-month pilot to remove peak time fares from ScotRail will start in October of this year. The evidence of this pilot and a wider fare fares review will allow us to bring forward further targeted measures from next year onwards to ensure that the cost of transport are more fairly shared. And as part of that commitment to active travel, we'll also ensure our investment to deliver more places where people can walk, where they can wheel and cycle safely for day-to-day journeys increases. We'll double the charge point network for electric vehicles to at least 6,000 and increase the number of zero-emission buses on Scotland's roads. We'll deliver six new major vessels to serve Scotland's ferry network. The final point that I want to highlight here is that local government is a vital partner in delivering the services that all of us rely on. We intend to agree and implement a new deal for local government to help us to work together more effectively. Part of that is about giving local authorities far more discretion on sources of funding. As we have previously confirmed, subject to Parliament's approval, we will legislate to give councils the power to apply a local visitor levy on overnight stays. And as we launched a consultation yesterday on measures which will give local authorities additional powers to increase the rate of council tax in second and empty properties. The consultation also seeks views on altering the threshold for self-catering accommodation to qualify for non-domestic rates. The consultation has come about as a result of effective joint working between the Scottish Government and local government, and I hope it demonstrates to local authorities that we see them as an essential partner in helping to achieve our ambitions for Scotland in years to come. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, when I was elected as party leader, I promised that I would never pretend that government is easy. It is not. I would not offer empty promises in the face of really difficult challenges. The document we're publishing today sets out our determination to honour that commitment. It is built on the idea of working in partnership with business, with trade unions, with local government, with our third sector, and of course our Green colleagues in government. It recognises the financial constraints we operate under. It's realistic about the social, the economic, the environmental challenges we face. But that realism is also balanced by optimism about our ability to meet those challenges. Scotland is a land of opportunity. I'm very proud of that fact. I'm proud to be a product of that. My grandparents came to this country in the 1960s, barely speaking English, little money in their pockets, despite the challenges they faced, and at times hostility they faced due to their background. They overcame those barriers and provided a life for their children and for their grandchildren that I will forever be grateful for. It's my responsibility as First Minister to ensure every family in Scotland has that equality of opportunity, regardless of their background or where they live in Scotland. I'm optimistic we can achieve that equality of opportunity, and the three missions that I have set out today will determine the priorities of the government that I lead for the rest of this parliamentary session and help us to achieve that. Together, we will be focused on the delivery. We will ensure that we have an affordable, ambitious measures in place which protect our environment, which protect business prosperity. They improve people's well-being and they reduce poverty. They will ensure the actions we take over the next 3 years stand Scotland in good stead for the next decade to come. And they will use our present, very significant strengths to deliver a fresh start for Scotland.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who would wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak button. And I call on Megan Gallagher.
Presiding Officer, the First Minister makes this statement today as scandal continues to engulf his party. The SNP is in total meltdown. Its former chief executive and now its current treasurer have been arrested amid a police investigation into the party's finances. And leaked footage has shown Nicola Sturgeon trying to shut down scrutiny mere months before the investigation began. Yet Hamza Yousaf is so indebted to his former mentors that he will not do the right thing and suspend them while the investigation is ongoing. It is past time that Hamza Yousaf tackled this scandal head on and proved to the Scottish public that he is his own man, instead of defending and deflecting from his predecessor's tarnished legacy. Turning to the substance of Hamza Yousaf's statement, we welcome the decision to U-turn on 13 years of SNP education policy and rejoin the international school league tables. We hope that this is just the beginning of a wholesale re-evaluation of how this government has devalued Scottish education over its time in office. Yet, as a whole, Hamza Yousaf's proposals does nothing to dispel the notion that he is a continuity First Minister leading a continuity government. Tinkering around with Nicola Sturgeon's failing policy agenda and continuing to be led by the extremist Greens instead of delivering the fresh leadership Scotland needs right now. And it will dismay the majority of the Scottish public that campaigning for independence is the top priority for Hamza Yousaf. At a time when Scotland needs national leadership focused on tackling the big challenges we all face, a global cost of living crisis, an NHS on its knees, thanks to this First Minister, and a sluggish economy, we have a nationalist leader continuing to appeal to his hopelessly divided party. So can I ask the First Minister on the commitments he makes in his threadbare document, whether anyone seriously believes that this government will close the attainment gap by the end of this Parliament? Secondly, on the deposit return scheme, we welcome the delay, which is a humiliation for the Green Minister, Lorna Slater, but can the First Minister promise this Scottish Government will engage with businesses on the deposit return scheme, which they have failed to do so far? And finally, given the scandal engulfing his party, can the First Minister tell me whether the SNP remains in debt to Peter Murrell, and when it intends to repay that loan?
First Minister, can I ask you to respond to the questions within your First Ministerial responsibilities? Thank you.
Yeah, indeed. Can I talk about the issues which I think are of importance to this people of Scotland? And what I would say to Megan Gallagher is awfully, awfully brave to talk about a global cost of living crisis. We're dealing with a Tory Westminster cost of living crisis. That is why the most recent IMF projections project that the UK government, in fact, an outlier, the lowest growth of any G7 economy. That's a Tory cost of living crisis. That's a union dividend Scotland definitely doesn't need. And you should own that as opposed to trying to deflect away from it. Presiding officer. What I would say is, of course, we have listened to Scottish business, and Lorna Slater will give further updates to the package of measures around the DRS scheme that we're bringing forward. But let's be honest, presiding officer. All of us talk about the need to tackle the climate emergency.
First Minister, excuse me a second. We need to hear the First Minister respond to the questions that Ms Gallagher raised. First Minister.
We are the ones who not only talk the talk, we are prepared to walk the walk. And when it comes to the Conservatives, every time we bring forward a measure on the climate emergency, they are the first ones to oppose it time and time again. So they're not serious, presiding officer. They are not serious at all about tackling the climate emergency. So we'll continue to talk and, of course, engage with not just business, but with the Scottish public about the priorities that they have. And may I say to Megan Gallagher, it is brave, some may use another word for it, when it comes to talking about propriety. Your Prime Minister, your Deputy Prime Minister and the former Prime Minister are all under investigation by the Standards Commission. So yes, while we absolutely face challenges, I'd rather be standing here with the opportunity to deliver for the people of Scotland rather than languishing in the opposition like Megan Gallagher and the Scottish Tories.
Before I call the next MSP, if we continue to make such noise, we cannot hear any of the answers, and I think that would be unfortunate. I call Anas Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Some of the announcements in the First Minister's statement today are welcome. Some of it is undoubtedly well-intentioned, but much of it is rehashed promises from the past that have never been delivered. But what Hamza Yousaf can't escape from is that he is not now running a functioning government. Yeah. This is an SNP that is mired in scandal, mired in division, talking to themselves about themselves. And the crisis that now engulfs the SNP is not just an indication of how they govern their party, but also how they govern our country. A 16-year culture of command and control, of financial mismanagement, and a lack of transparency, meaning secrecy and cover-ups, often with devastating consequences. And no amount of spin or the pretense of a reset or a fresh start is going to hide what is now becoming clearer to the public every single day. Our country is now crying out for leadership, for hope, for new ideas and a new vision to confront the twin crises our nation faces. A cost of living crisis with families struggling to pay the bills, and an NHS crisis with patients struggling to access life-saving treatment. Continuity won't cut it. Incompetence has consequences, and frankly, Scotland deserves better. But it doesn't need to be like this. This isn't as good as it gets. Change is possible. We can have a government that tackles the cost of living crisis and brings down bills. We can have a government that grows the economy and invests in the opportunities of the future. We can have a government that can restore and renew our NHS. And we can have a government that puts the people's priorities first. But after just 3 weeks in office, isn't it already clear that it can't be this First Minister or this SNP government?
First Minister.
Goodness, not a single idea, not a single proposal, not a single bit of understanding of the policy prospectus, completely vacuous from the master of the soundbite. No substance at all. All style and no substance whatsoever from Anas Sarwar, because he is vacuous, completely devoid of any policy proposals of his own whatsoever. And he says the Scottish Government in the last 16 years hasn't achieved anything. What we've achieved is the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which has helped 385,000 children under the age of 16 who are now eligible. We've established new public services, including, of course, Social Security Scotland, based on fairness, dignity and respect. That's delivering 13 benefits, 7 of them only available here in Scotland. We've delivered the baby box. We've abolished tuition fees. Of course, the backdoor tuition fees were something that were brought in by the Scottish Labour Party. We've abolished prescription charges. We've made sure that care is free for all when it comes to free personal and nursing care. We have now free bus travel for over 2 million people, for those who are under 22, for people with disabilities, with those over the age of 60. We've built 118,000 affordable homes. We've funded childcare. We have the most generous offer of childcare here in Scotland compared to anywhere else in the UK. And of course, the difference between Anas Sarwar and I is that when it comes to a Tory cost of living crisis, he wants to keep the powers in the hands of the Conservatives. I want to ensure this Parliament has all the financial and economic levers to tackle that cost of living crisis. And he says, Anas Sarwar says, the people of Scotland are crying out for change. What we don't need is a replacement of one Tory government with a pale imitation of a Tory government with Keir Starmer. Even Anas Sarwar must be embarrassed. I know certainly Richard Leonard will be. I know Anas Sarwar must be embarrassed by Keir Starmer appealing to the right with his anti-refugee, anti-immigration rhetoric. his inability to stand up for the most marginalised. And we know that it's only with the powers of independence will we get rid of Tory governments in Scotland for good.
I call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During Modern Apprenticeship Week, colleagues from across the Chamber will have heard directly from apprentices about the high-quality learning and work experience they receive. I know the First Minister will appreciate that apprenticeships also support economic renewal locally and nationally. Can I ask when Skills Development Scotland will issue contracts for 2023-2024 new starts and enable local training providers to clear the backlog of folk waiting and new start learners to begin their journeys to quality jobs on these excellent workplace learning programmes?
First Minister.
Can I thank Ruth Maguire for this question? Can I also pay credit to her? She has raised this issue, I know, on a number of occasions. Modern apprentices are, of course, a vital resource for employers to invest in their workforce. And I think all of us have seen that in our own home constituencies. Investing in skills across people's lifetimes is critical to our future productivity and delivering a fair, green and growing economy. My priority is for high-quality apprenticeships that provide sustainable jobs and careers supporting our transition to net zero. I can say that SDS have already issued contracts for the 39,000 modern apprentices currently in training and expect SDS to finalise contracts for new modern apprentices starts in the next few days.
I call Liz Smith to be followed by Claire Adamson. Ms Smith.
Can I ask the First Minister what detailed analysis has been undertaken by this new government when it comes to looking at the question of progressively increasing tax rates on middle and higher earners, a policy that's been proven in the past to actually reduce economic activity and weaken the tax state? What analysis has he undertaken to ensure that that is not going to happen in his Scottish Government and that will have very important implications for how we address the deficit that is being projected by the Scottish Fiscal Commission?
First Minister.
Can I say, of course, that detailed analysis is undertaken whenever we make tax changes. And I completely understand the point that Liz Smith is raising around, for example, tax divergence. That is an important factor in that analysis. But I am unapologetic in saying that I believe that those who earn the most, like Liz Smith and I and members of this Parliament, we should pay more. We earn more, and therefore we should pay more. I can hear Sue Webber disagreeing with that. But I think, of course, Sue Webber was the MSP that privately said that NHS workers should take a 20% pay cut, of course, in a scheme that she described as salary sacrifice. So I'm not sure I'm going to take financial advice from Sue Webber. What I would say is that our policy of progressive taxation that was announced in the budget by the former Deputy First Minister, that's allowed us to pay or to invest £1 billion extra in our NHS. So detailed analysis is undertaken. Of course, if I did listen to Liz Smith, indeed, if I listened to Douglas Ross, what we would have done, what she asked us to do, was replicate those disastrous tax cuts to the wealthy that Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng brought forward. That would have meant, instead of having £1 billion extra to spend, our budget would have been cut by £500 million. That's why I'm not sure I'll take economic literacy advice from the Conservatives.
I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Apollo Kane. Ms Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, Scotland can be proud of its global reputation as an open and outward-looking country. The recent Tartan Week in New York is an incredible celebration of our nation on the world stage, which makes James Cleverly's latest intervention on overseas meetings seem all the more insecure and desperate. Scottish ministers have a clear responsibility to promote Scotland internationally. In the face of the latest attempt to undermine our devolution by Westminster, will the First Minister reaffirm his government's commitment to championing Scotland on the world stage?
First Minister.
Absolutely. And of course, the Scottish Conservatives never even wanted the creation of this Scottish Parliament. So it's hardly a surprise that they are chipping away to try to undermine devolution every chance that they get. And I can absolutely reaffirm my intention and the government that I lead, our intention, to promote Scotland on the world stage. The UK government continues to deny the mandate from the people for a referendum on independence and encroach on devolution. And since Brexit, we've seen 9 breaches of the Sewell Convention, the imposition of the Internal Market Act, the veto of this Parliament's legislation passed by a majority on gender recognition, and the threat to give UK ministers powers to amend or scrap vital EU law in devolved areas. Our international and external engagement, often done in very good collaboration with UK embassies right across the world, is to the benefit of our Scottish food and drink industry, to our tourism sector, to our excellent higher education and further education sectors. It's often to the benefit of the life science and technology sectors, to our renewable sector. And when I think of that excellent, transformative, life-saving work done by our international development teams and our people-to-people relationship with Malawi, why on earth would the UK government want to try to put a stop to that? Well, we know why, because they are hell-bent on undermining devolution. While I'm First Minister, I'll do everything I possibly can to stop them from doing that.
I call Paul Kane to be followed by Evelyn Tweed. Mr. Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hundreds of Scots are struggling more than ever, and they need this government focused on their priorities. Child poverty has remained at 24% for the entire time the SNP has been in government, and severe child poverty has been rising. The First Minister has been a member of the Scottish Government for over a decade, and in various guises, he has failed to use the powers of this Parliament effectively to address the rising levels of very deep poverty. Presiding Officer, the First Minister has defined himself as a continuity candidate. Ain't that the truth? Isn't this prospectus just more of the same? Where are the new financial measures? How much of this is new money? How much of his £1.3 billion for the child payment is new money? Isn't it clear that Scotland needs more than just a summit on poverty? It needs action. Doesn't he realise that continuity won't cut it?
First Minister.
You see, that got a rapturous response from his own backbenchers, Presiding Officer, and quite rightly so. Because what was the first action I took when I was First Minister? I didn't just make sure we doubled the fuel insecurity fund, I made sure we tripled it. I made sure we invested £25 million additional funding for our just transition in the North East, because I'm going to take the workers of the North East with us on that just transition journey. I made sure we invested, I said, announced £15 million for school-aged childcare, targeted towards the lowest income households in the country. I made sure there was additional money for deep-end surgeries. Those are the GP surgeries that are located in the areas of highest deprivation. That's where my focus is, and that's where the focus of this government is. And what I would say to Paul O'Kane, where he and I don't differ, is that there is a need to make sure we go further in reducing and tackling child poverty. But let's not forget, we are doing that with one hand tied behind our back. And unfortunately, he wants to keep that hand tied behind our back, because the financial levers, the levers over employment, the levers over the economy, the substantial levers are still held by a Conservative government. But where we do have powers, we must go further. I'm absolutely happy to commit that when it comes to taxation, when it comes to, for example, how we redistribute wealth more evenly, that I'm committed to doing that. And that's why in that anti-poverty summit that he dismisses, I've made sure that we invite the opposition parties from the opposition. I hope he won't dismiss that invitation. I hope he and indeed Anas Sarwar will come to that summit, because where there are genuinely good ideas, I will make sure that we as a government listen to them and progress them together.
I call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton. Ms Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister how Scottish Government policies will account for the needs of and challenges faced by rural and island communities.
First Minister.
There is no doubt that opportunity, equality, community, those three driving missions, they're vital to everyone, no matter where you live, whether that's in rural, island, or indeed urban Scotland. Everybody will benefit from the actions that are taken to tackle poverty and cope with the cost of living crisis and support and strengthen our vital public services. We will ensure we take a tailored approach, taking full account of regional circumstances, working closely with our partners in rural and island areas. For example, I'm focused on housing in rural areas through that announcement I've already made, the £25 million fund for affordable homes for those who need it, including key workers. We're consulting on giving councils powers on council tax to raise council tax on second and long-term empty properties. That will help many parts of Scotland, but we know particularly our rural and island communities. And we'll also publish a rural delivery plan, setting out actions that this government is taking to support our rural and island communities.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Fergus Ewing. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, everyone, including those SNP backbenchers otherwise engaged today, knows that this First Minister's relaunch has been utterly torpedoed. And while he is focused on the turmoil within his own party, NHS waiting times are still being missed, more ferries are breaking down, and record amounts of sewage are being dumped into Scotland's rivers. This is a government in total paralysis. And for those reasonable-minded people finally rethinking their support for the SNP, there is an alternative, because Scottish Liberal Democrats will be part of the change that is coming. There is a nervous laughter, Presiding Officer, coming from these benches, but they know it's true. They know their vote is slipping away
from
them.
Mr Cole-Hamilton, I can't actually hear Mr Cole-Hamilton's question. Can we have Mr Cole-Hamilton, please?
I'm surprised you can hear me over the sound of CVs being frantically updated from the government benches. So I'd like to ask the First Minister, if I may, Presiding Officer, when he was Health Secretary, Humza Yousaf personally promised to clear down the atrocious mental health waiting list by this March 2023. That came and went. It was an utter failure. So can I ask, how many more years will it be before people are treated on time?
First Minister.
Can I say that yesterday I had the great pleasure of visiting Street Soccer, the chain centre in Dundee, and they managed to rope me into a game of six-a-sides with the excellent folk that are involved in engaging with Street Soccer. Made me think, in that game of six-a-sides, Alex Cole-Hamilton as Liberal Democrats couldn't even field a team with the four Liberal Democrat MSPs that they have. So when he talks about... Oh, was getting defence from his Conservative colleagues. There's a surprise. Their former coalition partners. So I'd be careful of boasting with too much confidence about the support that Alex Cole-Hamilton and the Liberal Democrats have here in Scotland. What I would say to Alex Cole-Hamilton is that the government is absolutely focused. It is one of our significant priorities, of course, to tackle those long waits, and far too long waits, in regards to mental health, but we are in CAMHS in particular. And we are making progress. Overall, CAMHS waiting lists have decreased by over 9% since the last quarter. That's a reduction of 777. In terms of children waiting over 18 weeks, that has decreased by over 30% since the last quarter. Children waiting over 52 weeks decreased by over 40%. Since the last quarter. And importantly and crucially, the number of children that are starting treatment from CAMHS in this quarter is the highest on record. So we're seeing more and more young people. But that's not to take away from the very important points that Alex Cole-Hamilton does raise. And we're committed to increasing the workforce within CAMHS, and we've seen that workforce continue to increase. But I take his points about mental health very seriously, and this government will be focused on that challenge.
I call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Mr Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At the SNP leadership hustings hosted by the excellent Inverness Courier and Highland News Media Group, the First Minister was asked whether he supported the duelling of the A9 from Perth to Inverness in toto and the duelling of the A96 from Inverness to Aldern, including the Nairn bypass. The First Minister gave very welcome commitments, welcome because they were entirely unequivocal. This will happen, and First Minister, you said, and I very much welcome it, the capital will be found. Therefore, can I ask when this excellent news will be the subject of a detailed ministerial statement, and given we've been treading water for 2 years, will this be before the summer recess?
First Minister.
Can I thank Fergus Ewing, and I spotted him, of course, during that leadership hustings by the excellent Inverness Courier. And just to give him an absolute assurance, we remain, of course, committed to the duelling of the A9. That commitment remains absolute. We've invested over £430 million. It's been spent to date. And, of course, I can understand completely the disappointment around the Tomatin to Moy section, and we're targeting a contract award before the end of 2023. If that can be brought forward, I'm engaged already with Transport Scotland to see if that can be brought forward in any way, shape or form. But I know Fergus Ewing understands our obligations to public finance and public spending. And we will provide, in terms of the remaining sections an updated timescale will be provided in autumn this year, but I've heard Fergus Ewing say, can we bring that timetable to before the summer recess, or take that away for consideration. And we do remain committed to not just improving the A96, but importantly, of course, dualling the Inverness to Nairn, including the Nairn bypass, with a view of completing the statutory process as soon as we possibly can.
I call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Ms Hamilton.
Sorry, officer. This government's reckless plan to ban fishing in large parts of Scotland's seas have been conveniently omitted from today's statement. Plans drawn up and implicitly listed in the SNP's deal with the Greens have provoked an outcry from coastal communities, the fishing industry, islanders and anyone who cares about Scotland's economy. Meanwhile, Scotland's farmers remain in the dark over SNP plans for future funding, despite rolling tractors on the Parliament's lawn just a few months ago. Details thin as gruel, this latest policy prospectus is more of the same from a government who remains out of touch with the priorities of rural Scotland. No mention of farming, no mention of fishing, no mention of agriculture, and one mention of rural, presiding officer. Will the First Minister listen to rural and coastal communities and drop the reckless HMPA proposals, and will he urgently deliver a new agricultural bill that supports rural Scotland?
First Minister.
This government has an excellent track record when it comes to working with our rural communities, but particularly our farming communities. And Rachel Hamilton can laugh all she wants. What's not a laughing matter is the hard Brexit that her party have imposed, which has harmed rural Scotland up and down the country. And what I would say around the important issue of highly protected marine areas, I have heard and I have listened to the concern, and we will listen to the concern of our coastal, our island, our fishing communities. The consultation, of course, did close yesterday. No criteria, no site selection has been made. We will analyse the consultation, but having spoken this morning to Marie McCallan, she will and we will as a government engage with those coastal communities, with those fishing communities, to hear on them. A very basic principle that we have always operated by, and I continue to reaffirm and confirm today, is that we are not going to impose these policies on communities that don't want them. So we'll work constructively with them. But let's not forget, let me go back to the point I was making to Megan Gallagher. We are facing twin crises of a climate emergency and nature and biodiversity loss. Every time we propose something, the Conservatives oppose it. Yeah. Now, it's really important that difficult decisions that we make get as much consensus in this Parliament as possible. Only by doing that, only by taking really difficult decisions, will we ensure that we tackle those twin crises. But I hear what a number of our communities, our fishing communities, our island communities are saying. Of course, this is an area that's of importance to the government, importance to our Green colleagues as well. But I'm sure we are in absolute agreement. I know we are in absolute agreement that we will work with our coastal communities, with our fishing communities, to see if we can find a way forward together.
Before I call the next member, I would advise that obviously time is marching on a bit. I would be keen to take as many members as possible. And obviously there are many important issues to be raised and responded to, but I would appreciate succinct questions and answers to match, First Minister. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister is rightly ambitious for Scotland, unlike his opponents who want most decisions to be taken by our next-door neighbour. However, to secure a Scotland where that doesn't happen, we need a growing, thriving and productive economy. Is that possible when workers earning £43,663 to £50,270 a year pay 54% of that marginal rate in income tax and national insurance, with VAT, fuel and excise duties eating into the rest? And does the First Minister accept the Scottish Fiscal Commission's view that high rates of marginal tax impact Scotland's productivity, inhibiting growth and diminishing the resources available to tackle poverty and deliver prosperity?
First Minister.
Well, Kenny Gibson, of course, raises an exceptionally important point. And I know why the groaning was coming from the Conservatives, because they, of course, unfortunately, are the ones who are in charge of the majority of the economic and financial levers. The disappointment doesn't come from the Conservatives, because I expect them to moan and groan about, you know, any time somebody who is wealthy has to pay more. My concern is more with the Labour Party, who want to keep those financial levers and those fiscal levers in the hands of the Conservatives, something I can't understand. So, yes, we will continue to work with business where we can. We will continue, and I will continue, to ensure not only do we bring forward progressive taxation, but where possible, ensure that we can distribute and redistribute the wealth that Scotland has more evenly. And going back to the point I was raising to Liz Smith, of course we will always, always ensure that there's robust analysis behind any of the spend or indeed tax decisions that we make. But my goodness, it would be so much more of an easier task if we had those full powers of independence, so we had the levers in our hands as opposed to the UK government's hands, who are hell-bent, of course, on only giving tax cuts to the wealthiest.
I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Ross Greer.
When it comes to business and the economy, I think the most remarkable thing about the First Minister's statement was that it scrapped and U-turned on more initiatives than it created or set up new measures. And indeed, the document itself is just merely bland postures and platitudes. Who's going to object to growing jobs, higher wages, or creating more businesses? Perhaps maybe other than the Green ministers who don't believe in growth. But there is no measures or no quantum, no criterion of success. So how many businesses will be created by 2026? What new training and support measures will be put in place to help people into higher wage work? And what reform will be undertaken of the cluttered landscape of enterprise support agencies? And overall, if the First Minister is so clear that there needs to be a new deal for business, what was wrong with the old deal?
First Minister.
Look, this is about a new leadership and an ability for a fresh start. And that's building upon the successes that the government has had. I mean, just think of the many businesses, the thousands, the tens of thousands, in fact, I think even more than that, that would not have survived the global pandemic if it wasn't for the measures that we had brought in place before the pandemic in terms of the small business bonus scheme. So we have worked incredibly hard with business over the years, but I also listen to business when they want a reset of that relationship. And that's why, yes, we'll take longer, for example, on the launch of the DRS scheme. That is listening to business. I'm certain if I had said that we would go live in August, I would have been castigated for that by the opposition. So there is, I'm afraid, no way that I'm going to be able to appease Daniel Johnson, despite, I suspect, my very best efforts. In terms of the points where I do agree with Daniel Johnson, I think his point around reforming the landscape, he called it a cluttered landscape, I think, reforming the landscape of agencies, I think that is something that is very, very worthy of attention. And I know that is something that the government, we are collectively looking at within government. In terms of the prospectus itself, what you have is a clear set of outcomes where you, as the opposition, and indeed the Scottish public, can hold us to account for the deliverability of those outcomes. And we have promised to report on those outcomes annually, and I'm sure Daniel Johnson will take great joy in holding the government to account in that regard.
I call Ross Greer to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you. The UK government has failed for years now to reach a decision on excluding Scotland's bottle deposit return scheme from the Internal Market Act. Now it very much looks like they've deliberately generated uncertainty to undermine the scheme, up to and including Alistair Jack misleading the House of Commons. This is Westminster's delay, but can the First Minister say what he and the Circular Economy Minister will do
Mr Greer, we need to hear Mr Greer's question, but a brief question would be appreciated. Thank you.
This is Westminster's delay, Presiding Officer, but can the First Minister say what he and the Circular Economy Minister will do to secure the exclusion and ensure that Scotland's scheme goes ahead next March?
First Minister.
There's no surprise that the Scottish Tories just do not understand devolution. There is no doubt whatsoever that not providing the exemption under the Internal Markets Act is existential to the deposit return scheme. We cannot progress a deposit return scheme if it was not for that exemption of the Internal Market Act, which we know far overreaches when it comes to issues of devolution. So I'm absolutely committed to the deposit return scheme. It will reduce littering substantially by a third. It will increase recycling rates of single-use drinks containers towards 90%. It will cut emissions by 4 million tonnes over 25 years. That's the equivalent of taking 83,000 cars off the road. And it's already delivered hundreds of millions of pounds of investment across Scotland, and it will creating over 500 new green jobs. But we do need that UK government exclusion, the IMA, the Internal Market Act, exclusion, and I know that we will do everything in our power. I also know that the UK government, certainly in some departments, DEFRA for example, are supportive of that exemption, but we know that Alistair Jack will do everything he possibly can to undermine this Parliament and undermine devolution. So we'll continue to do what we can on our end, but it would be helpful if those who say they support the deposit return scheme get behind the Scottish Government and persuading the UK Government to do the right thing and allow this scheme to go ahead next year.
I call John Mason to be followed by Sandhya Gulhani.
Thank you. I very much welcome what the First Minister said about being bolder on taxation and talking about redistribution of wealth. Can he say any more specifically on council tax, specifically both on the Second and Empty Homes initiative, and also longer term whether we can replace council tax?
First Minister.
Well, I have, of course, announced some changes, or the consultation to announce some possible changes jointly with COSLA in relation to council tax, because I do think we can possibly go further on council tax. So I'm really up for that discussion. There was an excellent STUC report published, I think, December last year, certainly towards the tail end of last year, which gave a number of policy suggestions that I think are very worthy of consideration from this government, many of them involving the reform to council tax, but also alternatives to council tax as well. So Scotland has led the way in delivering affordable housing right across the country. Between 2018 and 2022, we know that we've seen 59% more affordable homes delivered per head in the population than in comparison to England, for example. But I am keen to look at what we can do within the current council tax structures, but I certainly wouldn't rule out further reform of council tax, but also potentially looking at the alternatives to council tax, because we know we can do better.
I call Sandhya Gulhani to be followed by Emma Harper.
A real priority for the Scottish people is the recovery of our NHS and its sustainability for the future, not the continuity offered from the Sturgeon era. The First Minister leaves a woeful record in health. Primary care is where almost all healthcare is delivered, and the Maryhill Group GP practice in Elgin sent me a copy of their letter to the new Cabinet Secretary for Health, highlighting the growing threat of financial instability for GP practices. Practices are already short-staffed and under pressure, and the £65 million S&P cut from the primary care budget affects everyone and is undermining general practice. Will the First Minister commit to reinstating the £65 million to protect general practice and the future of the NHS?
First Minister.
Can I say, I think when I was speaking potentially earlier, when it came to the issues of social care, I did reference that there can be no NHS recovery without a social care recovery. I may have said that we would commit to a timetable to get to £10 an hour. Of course, forgive me if I said that, I meant £12 an hour, because that is, of course, I believe, a figure that will help with the workforce challenges that social care is currently facing, and adult social care in particular. So I'll give an absolute commitment to Sandhya Gulhani that when it comes to our NHS recovery, we believe that a social care recovery is vital to that. What's also vital to an NHS recovery? Well, what's vital to it is, of course, not having NHS staff feeling they have no choice but to go on strike, as they have done time and time again in, of course, Conservative-led England. They've done that, of course, because the Conservatives don't value our NHS staff in the way that the Scottish Government does value our NHS staff, and that's why they remain the best paid in it compared to anywhere else in the UK. So we'll ensure that we engage meaningfully, as the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care is doing with junior doctors just later this week as well, try to get to a point where we can hopefully prevent industrial action. And of course we'll continue to invest in primary care. It's fair to say, of course, we have a record number of GPs in Scotland, more per head than in the rest of the UK. We have 95 GPs here for every 100,000 people in Scotland, compared to 79 in England. But we're also committed to further increasing the number of GPs in Scotland by 800 by the end of 2027. And to answer his question directly, we are committed to investing an additional £1 billion in our NHS, which is only possible, of course, because we did not listen to the Conservatives' advice of giving tax cuts to the wealthiest, which would have meant £500 million less to spend in the Scottish Government's budget.
Before I call the next speaker, I would really have to say that we must have succinct questions and, First Minister, succinct answers. Otherwise, I will have to cut people from asking a question, and I would like to get in as many members as I possibly can. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, President Officer. The First Minister will be aware of many challenges we have across Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders, including the need for investment in roads and rail infrastructure so that we can keep young folk and attract businesses to the region. So given this, will the First Minister give a commitment that this government will pay attention to the needs of Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders, and will he advance SDPR2, and will the First Minister show that Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders are not forgotten, because we in the South are crucial to Scotland's future and our economy, our culture.
Thank you, Ms Harper. That's not brief, First Minister.
Thank you. In the interest of brevity, yes, I will commit to that. Of course, there are important improvements in the A77 and A75 that are part of STPR2. We will, of course, make sure that we make progress with them. The South of Scotland Enterprise £34.5 million budget will also improve business and community resilience. It will help to protect, but also crucially to create jobs as well. And this sits alongside the £85 million that we're investing to the Borderlands growth deal as well. So I'll do everything I can to ensure that this government meets the needs of the people of the South of Scotland.
Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, President Officer. This government has had 16 years to get childcare right, but still parents struggle. They find childcare is inflexible, doesn't wrap around their life, and what is available is only there for some kids of certain ages. It drives inequality, holds back opportunity, and fails community. That's why I welcome the commitment the Now FM made during his leadership campaign to deliver free childcare for 1- and 2-year-olds. Today's plan talks only of developing that childcare, not delivering it. This new government promised ambition, but we're yet to see it. Presiding Officer, there's a difference between being developed and being delivered. So can I ask the First Minister today, can you promise people who become parents over the next year that their child will have access to free childcare by the time they turn one?
First Minister.
I made it very clear during the election contest that Pam Duncan-Glancy refers to, that of course we would accelerate the expansion of childcare to 1- and 2-year-olds. That continues to be this government's priority. And just as a demonstration of how important childcare is as a priority to me and the government that I lead, one of the first announcements I made, of course, was of that £15 million for school-age childcare for those in the lowest income households. So absolutely committed to that. The point I take in relation to Pam Duncan-Glancy's question is we must work with the sector, because we know there are challenges around what they perceive to be equitable funding or the need for more equitable funding in relation to childcare costs. So I'm happy to engage, and I will be engaging with the sector directly, but I remain committed to the promises that I made during that election contest, which is that we will accelerate the expansion of childcare for 1- and 2-year-olds.
Call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, President Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. The mental health and wellbeing of children and young people is crucial in achieving the government's ambition to make Scotland the best place in the world to grow up. So can I ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government will do to ensure that children and young people's mental health and wellbeing is supported?
First Minister.
Can I thank Claire Hawkey for her question? What we will do is focus on ensuring that young people in particular get that timely access to mental health treatment they most definitely need. And I gave some examples of where we're making progress in my response. I think it was to Alex Coe-Hamilton's question. What we'll also continue to do is invest in CAMHS support staff. But what I'm also committed to doing, and this government will be committed to doing, is investing in those pre-crisis interventions as well. We know, of course, CAMHS and those who work in CAMHS do an excellent job, but we also know that if we can invest in earlier intervention, in that pre-crisis intervention, we know how useful, helpful and beneficial that can be to young people in Scotland. So Claire Hawkey should be in no doubt. She knows, of course, this area very, very well. She should be in no doubt whatsoever of this government's firm commitment to mental health, to bringing down waiting lists and backlogs, particularly for our young people.
I call Craig Hoy to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On the 28th of February, Lorna Slater said, and I quote, that no one with any credibility would delay the deposit return scheme. Given that he's just done that, was she right?
First Minister.
Of course, we know that the UK government's not granting the exemption of the Internal Markets Act is existential to the deposit return scheme. So to answer this question, no, the UK government are not credible, never will be credible, and that's why the Conservatives have been thrashed in every single election here in Scotland for over half a century.
And I can squeeze in, Mr Fairley, if I have a brief question for Mr Fairley and a succinct answer, First Minister. Mr Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. First Minister, yesterday I was at the climate change swap shop in my constituency in Lethem, where I was born. It's a place that helps people in desperate need of the most basic things, like furniture, bed linen, clothes, crockery, cups and cutlery. The demand for their service is now so great that the manager has asked me to help her find more volunteers. And that's a direct result of the policies of that party there, now being able to be helped by that party over there. So rather than independence being a distraction, as claimed by those unionist parties, does the First Minister agree with me that now more than ever, it's an absolute imperative to make sure that we can govern in this country in a way that makes Tory food banks and climate change swap shops a thing of the past?
First Minister.
I absolutely agree with what my colleague Jim Fairley has said. As I've said it today, independence is essential. We can't afford to be in this unequal union a day longer. Because what has it resulted in? It's resulted in a cost crisis. It's resulted in a hard Brexit, now supported by, of course, the Labour Party too. It's resulted in a policy where we turn back refugees that are in need. It's resulted, of course, in a policy where the UK's economic growth lags behind every other major economy in the world in the terms of the G7. So I absolutely agree with Jim Fairley that it's with the powers of independence we build a wealthier, a fairer, greener and more equal country, and I'll be doing everything I can to make sure independence is achieved in this country sooner rather than later.
Thank you, First Minister. That concludes the First Minister's statement. Point of order, Dr Gohani.
Of course, following my questions, I declare an interest as a working GP in the NHS.
Thank you, Dr Gohani. That will be noted on the record. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.